This is a conversation with Steven Fife for the Kentucky Marriage Equality and Religious Liberty Oral History Project. We are in the Barber Room of Camden Carroll Library on Morehead State's campus, located in Rowan County, Kentucky. It is 6 p.m., April 12th, 2017. My name is Dakota Barr. I'd like to thank you for taking the time to meet with me today, Steven.
Yeah, you're welcome.
I'd like to start with some biographical information, if you don't care, such as where you were born and where you grew up.
Well, I was born in Pikeville. Actually, I was born at Pikeville Methodist Hospital. I lived there until 8 years old, 9 years old, something in that ballpark. And then I moved to Morehead when my parents decided they were going to go to college here at Morehead State. And then I grew up here. Minus a stint in the Navy, I have been in Kentucky my entire life, in Morehead my life.
So Morehead, you consider it your home?
Yeah, Morehead's definitely home.
How has Morehead changed since you were younger? Culturally, physically, anything?
I would say Morehead has actually gotten more progressive than it used to be. My parents were actually warned about coming to Morehead State University because back in the early 90s when they decided, well, late 80s, early 90s, when they decided to do their degrees, they were told that Morehead was that queer school. And my father was very religious, and he would still argue with me to this day that he's not a bigot, but he was absolutely homophobic. I'd say Morehead has gotten way more tolerant. I mean, the fairness ordinance, just in and of itself, is miles above what I would have ever expected out of this little town.
Okay. If you don't care, just brush a little bit about your childhood and some of the experiences you went through.
Well, most of my experiences were on this campus. I used to run through the hills here, play in the creeks, the basic normal, what you would expect, Kentucky life, you know, catching crawdads and things like that. I grew up back before the age of the internet, so kids still played outside. Mm-hmm. I would say I had slightly different upbringing than certain people did. I was fortunate in the fact that my parents were intelligent and they were seeking to better themselves. A lot of Eastern Kentuckians, especially at that time, were mired in the don't get above your roots mentality. It actually caused kind of a rift in my family when my parents decided to do their degrees, because they were each respectively the first person in either of their families to do so. But that helped shape who I am. I was taught from a very early age to question things, find answers, learn. To this day, I'm 37 years old next month. I'm still in school working on a master's degree just because I love learning.
Okay. What about your religious upbringing and maybe some ideological background that you developed?
Well, I was actually raised Christian. We attended a handful of different churches. I was actually baptized at the Assembly of God Church here in Morehead when I was 16 or so. Religion was a really deeply embedded part of my life in my young adulthood even. At one point, about 20-ish or so, I seriously considered the possibility of being a pastor. So I would say, I mean, religion was definitely a big part of my upbringing, which I'm sure it is most people's here. I mean, I think we probably have more churches in Morehead than fast food restaurants, and that's saying something for a college town.
So is church something that was important to the family?
Church itself wasn't. Rarely did we actually go to church. Bible study, religious study, religious conversation, philosophical conversation, those were really important. And ultimately, that's what led to me changing my religious views as I became, as I grew into my adulthood. My father used to tell me all the time to never accept anything just because somebody said it. Find the answer for yourself, make up your own mind, read, look for more than one source, things like that. As a result of that, I read the Bible through and through. I looked for other sources that would corroborate biblical stories. I read books on biblical history. I mean, anything I could get my hands on that had to do with Christian history. And then I branched from there into other religions. So I started looking at Muslim history and Jewish history and Buddhist history. I looked at Mesopotamian religious mythology. I looked at Greek, Roman. I mean, anything I could find. And ultimately, that led to me becoming an atheist. I just reached a point where it all blended together, and I couldn't find any logical reasoning for any of it. So I set it aside.
Okay. So you're not currently involved with any church or religious organization?
Nope.
Okay. And what do you do for a living?
I work here at the university. I'm an academic program specialist for the College of Science Dean's Office. Basically, I'm a liaison between professors and department chairs and the dean.
Okay. All right. I'd like to ask you how you first became involved in the marriage equality movement. And this doesn't necessarily have to be the events that unfolded here in Morehead, but just generality.
I would say at first superficially, like most of the your armchair social justice warriors, I was a loud advocate for marriage equality. I absolutely believed in marriage equality, but I really wasn't doing a lot of activism or volunteer work or, you know, things in the community to help promote it, largely because it didn't really affect me personally. I was married to a woman. We had kids of our own. It wasn't really something that affected me on a personal level. So I could just kind of, and then go back to my life. I really, really got involved actively because of my cousin Jen. She's from Pike County. Her family has disowned her. She identifies as a pansexual. She's married to a woman in Chicago right now doing her PhD in linguistics. I've always been really, really protective of her because she was one of the only female cousins that I had. And, you know, in Kentucky, everybody takes care of their cousins, right? She was disowned and verbally assaulted by a number of family members, I don't know, probably 4 or 5 years ago at this point. And my wife and I were the only people who came to her defense. And that really made it hit home for me. That was the turning point, I think, where I went from being an observer to a participant. And then when the whole Kim Davis thing broke out, that was a chance for me to actively do something in my community, which isn't something that happens locally for us. I mean, you see the protests in D.C. or even Lexington, or, you know, it's usually away from us. So we don't get the chance to participate in that unless we're willing to, you know, give up a week of work or something like that, which most of us can't afford to do. So the Kim Davis, as much as I hate to say this, was a way to help bring local activists out of the woodwork.
I'd like to backtrack a little here, and being such a verbal and active voice for marriage equality and human rights, how did you first react when you heard the U.S. Supreme Court's decision making marriage equality the law of the land?
I was obviously happy. I was actually, I remember telling my wife, texting her, and you know, the Facebook message, everybody was celebrating about it and the whole yay. But I also remember feeling tempered by that because I knew there were going to be challenges to it. I didn't expect them to be quite as local as they were. But I mean, that's the way these things go. Progress is always slow and hard won, and there's going to be way more battles. I mean, even now with the Trump administration, I expect more challenges, even though it's set law.
Okay. So when you first heard this case, you were excited, mm-hmm. and the world's obviously changing, and in your view, the better.
Right.
And then here comes your local county clerk and says she's not going to issue marriage licenses. And this is in a town that you identify as progressive. And so how did that affect you? What went through your mind when you heard that in your town, there was somebody denying marriage licenses to all couples.
It was infuriating. I believe my exact words were, uh-uh, bitch. As I mentioned earlier, I'm an atheist, but I don't hold anybody's religion against them. More power to you. Believe what you want. Live your life. That I'm okay with that. That line stops, though, when your religion interferes with other people's ability to live their lives. And I think that's, aside from just the audacity that little county clerk Kim Davis thought that she could challenge the Supreme Court, there was also the aspect that she was challenging people who were very near and dear to me. She was challenging what I saw was hopeful progress for a very backward place in the country. I think the best way is just anger. It was just a whole lot of anger that needed to go somewhere.
So how did you channel that anger? Did you turn that anger into activism? Did you just go home and scream on the pillow? What'd you do?
Well, originally I went home and screamed and ranted and raved. I remembered pacing through my living room and my wife and I having a very heated, I don't want to say argument because we were in agreement with each other, but it was just a heated bitch session, which is when we said, what can we do about this? And we, a couple of friends of ours had come up with the idea that we were going to start protesting. And we said, yes, that's it. So that's exactly what we did. We went to the Rowan County Courthouse day in and day out protesting Kim Davis and her decision to defy the Supreme Court of the United States of America.
So when did you become involved? Was this like day one, the first protest?
Or? Oh, yeah. Day one. I was there, and every day that I could feasibly do so without getting fired from my job, I did so. I think for me personally, the biggest protest day was in August. We had the last Saturday of the month, or the first Saturday of the month, I can't remember which was now, but it was a Saturday protest, which we hadn't normally been able to do because obviously the county clerk's office isn't open on Saturdays, except for this one Saturday a month. So we planned a huge protest for that day, and we got a bunch of people who came out for that. That was probably the big day protesting for me, just because the number of people who came out to participate. That was when it really started to set in for me that it wasn't just a small ragtag group of progressives in Eastern Kentucky who cared about this. There were a lot of us. We were a voice. We could be heard. We could make a difference. We could start to change not just Morehead, but Rowan County, Eastern Kentucky, eventually the entire state, to a more progressive way of thinking, which is what we're still working on.
So when you went to these protests, what was your immediate goal? Did you want to see her out of office? Was your main concern getting licenses issued? What was your thought process here?
My main concern was getting licenses issued. Her being removed from office was a battle to be fought later. My concern was there were a number of clerks in that office who could issue marriage licenses, and they all had kowtowed to Kim Davis's dictatorial regime, as it were. And that was just incomprehensible to me, that one person could have that much authority over people who literally, they just want to share love. I mean, she claims that she's this Christian and she's standing in the way of love, which is the single thing Jesus Christ preached about the most. Love each other. That was his central tenet. Love each other. Take care of each other. What you do unto others, you do to me. And she's blocking people.
Did you see this more of a religious liberty issue? Was it a human rights issue? Was it just that your town was on the news and you wanted to defend its honor? What was this issue to you?
The civil rights, human rights, basic human dignity. I mean, equal protection under the law is in our Constitution. That means everyone gets equal protection and equal representation under the law. The Supreme Court upheld that ideology when they said marriage equality. And then Kim Davis tried to just stop doing that. For me, the religious component was more of a hypocrisy than anything. Like I said, she self-defines herself as a Christian, and in my personal opinion, from everything that I've read, Jesus' central tenet was to love each other, and she's standing in the way of that.
You mentioned the attendance at the rallies, mm-hmm. how sometimes they were huge and sometimes there'd be almost nobody there.
Right.
But what was the environment like? Did you ever at any point feel unsafe attending a protest? Or
There were a couple of times, and I would say probably in large part due to rhetoric that was going around on Facebook about groups coming in with guns and things like that, that you would feel a little nervous about going out there. But I mean, anytime you're going to protest, that's part and parcel to it. There's going to be some danger. Even peaceful protests, we've seen repeatedly at this point where peaceful protests are broken up violently by police forces. And honestly, I didn't see the Rowan County Sheriff's Office rolling up with, you know, tear gas, but I mean, nothing's out of the realm of possibility. I was more concerned with the random local right-winger doing a drive-by, popping off a couple of shots, that kind of thing. And mostly just because my two sons participated in the protests as often as they could as well. My wife was there protesting. I had a number of friends. I mean, it was more of a concern for... I think I was more concerned about my family than I was about what would happen to me. I mean, thinking back about it now, I don't recall ever being worried for my personal safety. I was worried for my sons.
Do you think your tactics were effective in the protest? And if not, what would you change about it?
I think we made noise. I mean, we hit Kim Davis really, really hard, but I don't think we held our other local elected officials' feet to the fire anywhere near enough. We should have been going after Rocky Adkins. We should have held him firm and made him come out with support one way or the other. I mean, this I'm going to straddle the fence so that I don't offend the voters thing doesn't sit well with me. Either you have conviction or you don't. So as far as really hitting Kim Davis, making noise, I mean, it went international. I mean, there were reports from everywhere. There was that one office in Seattle that kept faxing her repeatedly throughout the day. I mean, we made a lot of noise, and marriage licenses are being issued in Rowan County, even to same-sex couples. So ultimately, I mean, we won. I just feel like we left it open to challenge, and we let the county say it's okay for her to do this, and it's not. She should not be in office right now.
So do you think the protests made a difference in terms of the outcome, or do you think it maybe just sped up the process?
I think it made a difference in terms of the outcome. Had nobody stood up and said anything, she would have just been allowed to do what she was going to do, because our elected officials don't go to bat in this county. I mean, they're all about, let's make as few waves as possible, because the city is very progressive. The county, not so much. So all of our elected officials walk a really thin line as far as being reelected, and like I've said before, I detest people who won't stand up for their conviction. Either you believe in something or you don't, and if you're not willing to stand up for it, you don't deserve to be in office, because at that point you're just filling the seat because you want the paycheck.
Did you continue your activism in any way once this whole ordeal was settled?
I did. I was an active participant in the Rowan County Rights Coalition. who sought to continue that progressive ideology into meaningful electoral change, public education. Ultimately, we parted ways because we had a differing view on how things should be run. And they're still doing their thing. They have a class they're putting on, I think, next week. That's a great educational opportunity. I mean, they're still doing things in the community. And there were a couple other splinter groups that have come about as a part of it. I mean, if nothing else, you've had several different organizations step up and try to do things in the community and be actively engaged. I mean, people are going to differ in opinion about how they think that should be done. That's never going to change. But at least there are people doing it. This is something that didn't happen before. Everybody just sat back and let the politicians run things the same old, same old. I mean, it's the good old boys network. Nepotism ran rampant. I mean, there have been studies now that show Kentucky is one of the most corrupt governments in the country. Hopefully, this kind of sentiment can spread, and we can change that. This, I view for me personally, as more than just marriage equality. This can be a springboard towards a more progressive Kentucky. We can leave a better legacy for our children than growing up in poverty and religion and dying in a coal mine.
Did you learn anything about like how government works through this process?
A few things I would say. I've always been pretty avid follower of government. My dad was very involved in politics, and I was the oldest, and he would frequently tell me, "Steven, come here, watch this." So I can remember watching the Berlin Wall come down. I can remember Ronnie Reagan's speeches when I was little. I remember the Bill Clinton scandals and the way Bill Clinton handled the economy. I would say, if anything else, this has helped me become really tuned into local politics. I know a lot more about specifically where local elected officials stand on issues, even issues they don't voice publicly, and that helps. Because if you know those things, you can help kind of twist their arm a little bit, push them the way things need to be going.
So do you think Morehead has changed, or Rowan County as a whole has changed any because of this issue?
Marginally. I think we have people who are progressive feel empowered. They're able to stand out and make their voices heard more. So within the county, progressive voices are becoming louder. Within the city, they already were pretty loud. But it's only marginally. And I'm going to give you an example. Recently, the Department for Community-Based Service put on a Family Fun Day. They do one of these every year. It's a big hot dog fest where they have, you know, characters come out and all the kids can come and they play games and they give them prizes and things like that, right? So you have all of the DCBS officials there, working booths and things like that. The mayor, Jim Tom, was there. Other local elected officials stopped by, including Kim Davis, who was there. I imagine she was there helping support her son, who works for DCBS, or her daughter, who works for DCBS, and son-in-law, I should say. My wife and myself, who were both a very loud, active opposition to Kim Davis, were also there. My wife was playing the part of Belle, walking around being a princess. So, I mean, it goes back to what we were saying during the protest. It's such a small community that even though we have these diametrically opposed ideas, at the end of the day, we still have to live, work with each other. So I suppose we've all had to try to learn to walk that line between being politically active and not breaking out into another, you know, Mark Tolliver feud. Which, at least I'm proud to say, there has been no violence that I'm aware of at any point as a result of this, so.
Is keeping your opinion under wraps a hard thing for you to do?
For me? Yeah. No. I don't ever keep my opinion under wraps. I don't have to be mean about it, though. I mean, you can absolutely disagree with somebody and do it in a nice way. There's no reason to be violent with each other. There's no reason to, you know, resort to name-calling. If you have to resort to calling people names, you've lost the argument, as far as I'm concerned. But that doesn't mean that you have to just sit quietly with your hands folded in your lap when you're around somebody who is actively spouting something that you disagree with, especially in your community. So, I mean, I'm not at all the person who will just sit and be quiet and keep my position under wraps. I think basically everybody who knows me knows exactly where I stand on everything.
Well, I'd like to see where you stand on the topic of religious liberty.
Okay.
Because you talked about possibly becoming a pastor or mm-hmm. minister, and you obviously have a strong opinion on what religious liberty means to you.
Yep.
So with that being said, I'd like to get your thoughts on the county clerk's words saying that this was just her religious liberty. Do you think that that's a fair assessment, or do you think that, or do you feel other?
No, I don't think that's a fair assessment at all. Her religious liberty ends at the door to the courthouse. Her role as a state elected official is secular in nature. So the issuing of licenses, the levying of taxes, all of these things should be done in a secular manner. It's basic separation of church and state. I'm sure she felt like she was being oppressed because she doesn't believe in marriage equality. So why would she have to issue marriage licenses? That's the job. I mean, your religious liberty at that point is, if you choose not to do that, then you step down. That's the choice that you have to make. It goes to a basic misunderstanding. People misunderstand a lot of our basic freedoms. Freedom of speech, for instance, doesn't prevent you from any kind of repercussions. If you're spouting off on Facebook, you're fair game. People are allowed to spout their opinions back at you. It prevents you from being put in jail for saying bad things about the president. That's it. That's what it does. Religious liberty allows you to practice your religion on your own time. That's what it does. It means that the government can't interfere with whatever you want to do religiously, barring, you know, certain things for the common good, like you're not allowed to have virgin sacrifices and things like that. Those are should be common sense. But as far as breaking established law because it doesn't suit you, absolutely not. I mean, where does that stop? I mean, suppose an atheist is in office, if we ever get one, and I decide that I don't want to issue marriage licenses because I don't believe in the institution of religious marriage. Am I just allowed not to issue marriage licenses, period, because it was an idea that was thought up by religion? If you frame it that way, they would say absolutely not. You still have to do this. I have the right to marry the woman I love or the man I love. It's no different. It's just, in my opinion, Christians feel like they get to bend the rules in their favor because they get this viewpoint that it's a Christian nation when it isn't.
So you felt that she violated the barrier that is the separation of church and state?
Absolutely.
And so when she did that, what do you think should have been done to handle the situation?
Well, at that point, other elected officials, our county elected officials, should have stepped in and given her the dictum. Either you're going to follow this or you're going to have to resign. Those are your options. This is the law. You're an elected official. You represent these people. You have to follow this law. They didn't do that. As I mentioned before, our elected officials don't like to stick their head out of the sand if they don't have to. And unfortunately, when we were protesting, we didn't do anywhere near enough job of attacking the rest of them. I mean, we should have been holding all of our county elected officials responsible and not just focus on Kim.
Do you believe she deserved to be imprisoned?
Imprisoned? No. I think she should have been removed. I think she should have been impeached. I think it was the judge's discretion to hold her in contempt. And far be it from me to interfere with that. I think in the end, being imprisoned just served to help her cause. I mean, she got Mike Huckabee down here. I mean, she got everybody on the religious right fired up. Really, it was a short-sighted decision for people who are on the marriage equality side, because all it did was throw fuel on the fire.
How do you think the media covered this whole story? I mean, we had international news organizations here in our tiny town of Morehead covering this story. Do you think that their coverage was appropriate?
I think the media's coverage was the exact same as the media coverage always is. It's a sensationalized version of the truth designed to catch headlines. Period. All they want is clicks and views. That's it. The genuine issue here is way more complex than any of them portrayed it to be, and it's still ongoing. And where are they now? Kim Davis is still the county clerk. Kim Davis herself still does not issue marriage licenses. Brian Mason does. I mean, when it comes right down to it, nothing really she was not affected by this other than getting her 15 minutes of fame.
What did the media get right about the coverage, if anything?
They did a good job of showcasing the fact that we're not all a bunch of backward, super religious hillbillies. They did a good job of showing activists who are a good representation of the people who are in Kentucky, as opposed to the usual, let's get somebody who's in a house coat and curlers that they go for. Let's find the most backward-looking person in the area that we can put on TV so that we can perpetuate that hillbilly stereotype just a little bit more. So as far as that goes, they got that right. They were not just, you know, showing hillbillies against hillbillies. They did not I'm amazed that they didn't portray this as another feud. I really am. So I'll give them credit for that.
Do you think the media coverage changed the outcome of this event?
Oh, yeah. I mean, as sensationalized as it was, and the fact that I hate that they do that with every news story that comes in the 24-hour cycle, the fact that it went international really forced attention to the issue. Otherwise, it would have just been a handful of people who sat outside of Kim's office, and it would have eventually just petered out, because none of the elected officials were forcing her to do anything. So without the media coverage, we wouldn't have been able to force any kind of resolution to that. Without the media coverage, that judge would probably not have held her in contempt of court. Without the media coverage, the court decision may not have been what it was. I mean, they would have been able to go to court in Rowan County to start with, and I can guarantee you that would have been a completely different decision in Rowan County.
Regarding marriage equality and LGBTQ equality in general, many people saw marriage equality itself as the biggest battle. And that battle's won, at least for the most part. So do you think the fight is over? Or
for LGBTQ equality?
Yeah, was that the end game?
No. That's not even close. North Carolina just put a bill out to overturn gay marriage in their state. You have state after state that's doing the anti-transgender bathroom bills and ordinances, or repealing ones that were already in place. To quote basically anybody on the right, this is Trump's America now. So all of these protections that we have in place that have been hard fought for the last 30, 40 years, they're in danger of being dialed back. I mean, protections in the workplace are still important. Anti-discrimination in housing is still important. These are all things that are challenged frequently at local and state levels that ultimately are going to have to be decided with either a constitutional amendment or Supreme Court rulings. And unfortunately now, since they decided to stall and not let President Obama put a Supreme Court justice on, and they forced through Neil Gorsuch, he stands to do whatever he wants to at this point. We have a right-leaning Supreme Court that could literally dial back any of these decisions if they're challenged. So no, it's marriage equality is not safe at the moment, and it won't be until there's a constitutional amendment in place, in my opinion.
Okay. So what ongoing work do you plan on doing in these areas? Like, how do you plan on fighting back against these movements against marriage equality?
For me personally, I've decided I'm going to run for office. I've done the volunteer work, I've done activism, I've been a part of these things, and I will continue to do so, but people keep saying all the time, if you're a progressive, run. If you want to see change and make a difference, run. And I would tell anybody else who hears this interview, even 20, 30, 50, 100 years from now, if you want to make a difference in your community, run. There's nothing that stands in your way but you. And that's been something that's really hard to overcome. When you grow up poor, I mean, being an elected official is something the rich folk do. And I will most likely lose. But at least I'm going to try. And I'll continue to participate in as much activism as I can find time to do. And hopefully, when I finish my PhD, I can do research in Appalachian culture, which is a completely different topic. Mostly, I feel like we just need to stay loud. Stay loud, continue educating ourselves, and continue fighting. Because it's not going to be over. You just have to keep pushing.
You have any positions in mind that you're considering running for?
Several. I could take the easier route and do something very small and local and run for school board. I still have two kids in the school system. School board is something I would be interested in doing. State Senate would probably be much, much harder to win. I could probably carry Rowan County just because it's so progressive, but in our district, it's very GOP leaning. There are a couple of elected officials that I wouldn't want to upset. I would absolutely love to unseat Hal Rogers. He's run unopposed in Congress for, I think, the last 3, 4, maybe 5 elections. The Democrats don't even bother to put up an opposition to him at this point. Unfortunately, without tremendous backing from the Democratic Commission, you're not going to have the funds to run that kind of a race. So it'll likely just be a local office. My wife tells me I should run against Kim Davis, because she's up for re-election. And she's going to run as a Republican this time. So just having a D beside your name might help. But honestly, I'm still doing my research to figure out which one I would be best suited for. Okay.
All right, so I really just have one more question for you.
Okay.
And I want to know how this whole experience has changed you as a person.
Oh, I think that goes back to what I said almost at the beginning of the interview. I have changed from being an observer to being an activist. I'm no longer content to sit back and complain about the fact that the system doesn't work for people like me. I feel obligated at this point to participate, to change things. That's why I changed my master's degree even. I was an MBA student before because that's where the money is. I changed to sociology because I feel like it's my obligation to help educate Eastern Kentucky, to help bring about a more prosperous, a more progressive, a more I guess a better Eastern Kentucky. I can't leave that to my kids to do later. That's something we should all be doing now.
Well, you're obviously very passionate, and I'd like to thank you so much for taking the time to sit down with us and sharing your thoughts.
You're welcome.